Refrigeration engineering is that branch of engineering which deals with production of low temperatures and maintaining them. The term refrigeration is defined as the maintenance of a body or a system at a temperature lower than its surroundings by continuous removal of heat from it. This heat that is removed from low temperature system has to be rejected to its surroundings, which are always at a temperature higher than the body temperature that has been shown in the figure here. The system is at a lower temperature, heat is required to be removed from lower temperature body and it has to be rejected to a body which is higher which is at a higher temperature, normally it is atmosphere. And such a system which does this type of operation is known as refrigeration system. As such, some external work is required to pump this heat from a lower temperature heat source to a higher temperature heat sink. As per Clausius statement of second law of thermodynamics, some energy is required to pump this heat and the device is known as a refrigerator or a heat pump. The Clausius statement for second law of thermodynamics states that it is impossible to construct a device that operates in a thermodynamic cycle and produces no effect other than transfer of heat from a low temperature heat reservoir to a high temperature heat reservoir. Second law of thermodynamics says that this type of device is impossible. It operates in a thermodynamic cycle, takes heat at a lower temperature and rejects it to a higher temperature. And therefore, to make it possible, to make the refrigeration system possible, what is needed is to operate this device with the help of some external energy. This device would be possible only if certain amount of mechanical or heat energy is supplied to a device, and in that case heat will be absorbed from a lower temperature and it can be rejected at a higher temperature. So, this is what has been discussed, and by Clausius statement we can say that this is the basic fundamental of a refrigeration device. Now, let us come to the performance parameters for refrigerating devices or heat pumps. First of all, the cooling capacity. Cooling capacity is the rate of heat removal from a refrigerated space and it is expressed in terms of tons of refrigeration. 1 ton of refrigeration is defined as the quantity of heat that is required to be removed from 1 ton of water at 0 degrees centigrade to freeze it into ice at 0 degree centigrade in 24 hours. It is equivalent to 211 kilojoules per minute or 3.516 kilowatts. This has been deduced on the basis of, initially it was defined that 1 ton of refrigeration is equal to 200 British thermal units per minute, and that has been converted to give the equivalent ton of refrigeration in SI units as 211 kilojoules per minute or 3.516 kilowatts. Next parameter that defines the performance is the coefficient of performance. As we define the performance of power cycles by the term efficiency, thermal efficiency, similarly performance of a refrigerating device is defined by coefficient of performance, and it is the term used to express the performance of a refrigeration device. It is defined as the ratio of net refrigerating effect to the work input. The refrigerating effect means the total heat that is being removed from low temperature body, that is termed as refrigerating effect. And to produce that refrigerating effect, how much is the energy that is required, ratio of the two is defined as the coefficient of performance. The coefficient of performance is defined as the net refrigerating effect divided by the work input N by W. In this system, this is the quantity of heat removed, this is the quantity of heat rejected, and this is the work input of the system. Then the coefficient of performance of this refrigerating device would be the refrigerating effect Q L divided by the net work done. Net work done will be Q H minus Q L. So, Q L upon Q H minus Q L, or we can write it as T L upon T H minus T L. Coefficient of performance is just reverse of the efficiency of a heat engine cycle. Efficiency of heat engine cycle was defined as the net work done divided by the heat supplied, Q H minus Q L upon Q H, and that was equal to T H minus T L by T H. This was derived in second law of thermodynamics. And similarly, the coefficient of performance of refrigeration cycle is defined by T L upon T H minus T L. If we compare this with this, we find that the coefficient of performance is just reverse of the efficiency of a thermo power cycle, that is very clear from here. And of course, we could have defined this performance parameter by efficiency of refrigerators, but we do not do it because of certain reasons, that the efficiency of a power cycle is always less than 1, whereas coefficient of performance of refrigerating devices is normally higher than 1. And therefore, if we define by term efficiency, that would be confusing, and therefore, we use another term, that is coefficient of performance in place of efficiency. Then let us come to the refrigeration systems. It has been explained earlier that the power cycles are reversible cycles. All reversible cycles are the most efficient cycles, and all power cycles, say Otto cycle, diesel cycle, dual cycle or Brayton cycle, they are reversible cycles. And these reversible cycles, they draw heat at a high temperature source and reject this heat at a lower temperature, and the net output of the cycle is the work done. Whereas, these cycles being reversible in nature, if these cycles are reversed, the direction of cycle is reversed, their direction has been reversed, and in that case, as per definition, whatever is the work done in a power cycle will be the amount of work that will be consumed in reversed cycle, and instead of heat that is being rejected, it will be drawn at a lower temperature, and it will be rejected at a higher temperature. That is, the cycle becomes a reversed power cycle or a refrigeration cycle. It has been shown in diagram here. This is a power cycle on TS diagram. in a power cycle, we can see that the power cycle moves in a clockwise direction, whereas a reversed power cycle, the direction has been reversed and it moves in the anticlockwise direction. And the net effect is that the work is being consumed and heat is being absorbed at a lower temperature and rejected at a higher temperature. In this, this is the amount of heat heat supplied to the system. This total amount is the amount of total heat supplied. Out of this total heat supplied, this is the amount of work that has been obtained and this is the amount of heat that has been rejected. Whereas, in the reversed cycle, everything that has been reversed, the direction has been changed, the amount of heat absorbed is this much, that this is the refrigerating effect. And it will consume this much amount of work, and in the process the total amount of heat that will be rejected is given by the total area under this curve, right. So, when a power cycle is reversed completely, we consume work instead of doing work and some net refrigerating effect is being produced. The refrigeration cycles can also be classified like power cycles as gas or air refrigeration cycles and vapor refrigeration cycles. The gas the power cycles were gas power cycles and vapor power cycles. Similarly, the refrigeration cycles are also gas or air refrigeration cycles and vapor refrigeration cycles. An ideal refrigeration cycle is a reversed Carnot cycle. However, it has been stated earlier that Carnot cycle is not a practical cycle and modifications are needed to make it a practical cycle. Some modifications were discussed in power cycles and the same modifications make a reversed Carnot cycle a practical refrigeration cycle. And if those modifications are applied to a Brayton cycle or Joule cycle, that would give a reversed Brayton, reversed Joule cycle, and that would be a Brayton refrigeration cycle or Joule refrigeration cycle, air refrigeration cycle. A Brayton or Joule cycle, if reversed, becomes air refrigeration cycle. A reversed Brayton cycle consists of two isentropic and two constant pressure processes as shown here. The refrigeration and the power cycle has been shown here. 1 to 2 is constant pressure heat rejection process. Then 2 to 3 is compression process isentropic, then 3 to 4 is heat addition process at constant pressure, and 4 to 1 is isentropic expansion process. The cycle has been reversed, the direction changes. Instead of being a clockwise cycle, it becomes a anti-clockwise cycle. 1 to 2 is the isentropic compression process, then 2 to 3 it the heat is rejected at higher temperature, at higher pressure, and 3 to 4 the expansion takes place isentropically, the pressure and temperature they fall down, and at 4 the heat 4 to 1 heat is added at constant pressure. That has been shown on TS diagrams also. 1 to is compression isentropic on the vertical line, then 2 to 3 is constant pressure process, and the temperature falls down, the cooling takes place. 3 to 4 is again isentropic expansion process, and 4 to 1 it picks up heat and therefore its temperature increases. It's very clear. So that this cycle is shown on schematic diagram and also on TS diagrams. This is the compressor. 1 to 2 the compression takes place isentropically in a compressor. Then this high pressure and high temperature air flows into a heat exchanger, where because of its high temperature the heat is lost to the environment, the atmosphere. The temperature drops down, and at point 3 when the air comes out of the heat exchanger, the temperature is low, it is near to the atmospheric temperature, and pressure is high. So this high pressure and low temperature air, when expands in a turbine, certain amount of work will be done by the air and the temperature will fall down. This low temperature chilled air then passes in the heat exchanger, where it will pick up heat at a lower temperature, and again this heat the cycle will be completed as it goes into the compressor. Part whatever is the power generated in the turbine, it is consumed in the compressor, and the balance power, balance work will be supplied from the external source. TS diagram I have already explained, and this this analysis of the cycle has been done. The work that is consumed in the compressor will be Cp into T2 minus T1. This is the compressor process, compression process. So work done will be Cp into T2 minus T1, heat picked up, that is the work done. Then 2 to 3 the work done in the turbine would be Cp into T3 minus T4, and therefore the net work done will be work of compressor minus work of turbine, that is supplied from the external source, and this is the work done on the cycle. And the refrigerating effect would be heat picked up during process 4 to 1, that is Cp into T1 minus T4. This is the amount of heat picked up, and therefore coefficient of performance would be N upon W. Substituting this value N and W, we get this expression. Cp being common, it cancels off, and ultimately we are left with this equation T4 into T1 upon T4 minus 1 divided by T3 into T2 by T3 minus 1 minus T4 into T1 by T4 minus 1. We can again say that the pressure ratios are, this is a constant pressure line, this is also a constant pressure line, and therefore P2 by P1 will be equal to T2 by T1 raised to power gamma minus 1 by gamma. This is from the gas equation that we can derive. And similarly T3 by T4 will be equal to, for this process, expansion process, T3 by T4 will be equal to P3 by P4 raised to power gamma minus 1 by gamma. Now P2 is equal to P3, this is a constant pressure line, P3 will be equal to P2, P3 equal to P2, and again this is also a constant pressure line, and therefore P1 will be equal to P4. So we can write that T2 by T1 will be equal to T3 by T4, because pressure ratios are equal, the temperature ratios will also become equal. This equation can be rewritten as T2 upon T3 equal to T1 upon T4. Substituting this value in the earlier equation here, T4 by T1 is equal to T2 by T3, we get the coefficient of performance as T4 upon T3 minus T4. We can write this as 1 upon T3 by T4 minus 1, or 1 upon R raised to power gamma minus 1 upon gamma. So this gives us the coefficient of performance for a reverse Brayton cycle, and it is comparable. We can compare it with the efficiency, thermal efficiency of a Brayton cycle that we had derived earlier, and we find that this particular this particular coefficient performance gives us the coefficient of performance for an ideal air refrigeration cycle. The main application of air refrigeration systems is in aircraft air conditioning, as it serves the dual purpose of removing heat and pressurizing passenger cabins at high altitudes. At high altitudes, the atmospheric pressures are very low, and in passenger planes, pressurization is extremely necessary, because the occupants will feel uncomfortable, they cannot survive at low pressures, and therefore, the cabins have to be kept under normal atmospheric pressure, and therefore, air is to be supplied at the atmospheric pressure into the passenger cabin, and that can be done if we use air refrigeration system for cooling and air conditioning of passenger planes at high altitudes. A simple aircraft air conditioning cycle has been shown here. The atmospheric air is compressed in the compressor, as shown here. This is the main compressor, the power compressor of the aircraft. This power compressor compresses the air. This compressed air then passes on to the power turbine, and a small fraction of this air compressed is used for aircraft refrigeration. This air that has been bled from the compressor turbine passes in the heat exchanger. In the heat exchanger, atmospheric air, ram air, is used for cooling the compressed air. The temperature of the compressed air reduces, and this cooled air then passes on to the cooling turbine, where it expands, and this cooled chilled air at desired pressure is supplied to the aircraft cabin, and it can take care of the heating loads as well as pressurization needs of the passengers. The cycle is shown on a TS diagram here. This 1 to 2 is ram effect. The air is compressed because of the speed of the aircraft, very high speed. The stagnation temperature is P2 and the stagnation temperature is T2. So, this is known as ram compression 1 to 2. 2 to 3 is the compression in the main compressor. Then 3 to 4 is the cooling that takes place in the turbine, and from 4 to 5 the expansion takes place in the cooling turbine, and this 5 is the required cabin pressure at which the cabin is required to be maintained. And this is how we can make use of this particular cycle for aircraft air conditioning. This particular cycle, of course, is useful for smaller planes or fighter planes, but for large passenger planes where air conditioning requirements are high and the quantities of air for pressurization are also large, this particular cycle may not be sufficient, and for that bootstrap cycle is made use of. This is a two-stage cycle. The capacity is limited, capacity of simple cycle is limited and may not be sufficient for large passenger planes. To improve its performance, a two-stage cycle known as bootstrap cycle is being used. This cycle is shown here. This is atmospheric air, one is atmospheric air. This atmospheric air is, because of the speed of the aircraft, is compressed, that is known as the ram action, up to 2. At point 2, this ram air enters the main compressor of the aeroplane. This air compressed in the aeroplane then passes on to the turbine, and some air is extracted. It passes through the heat exchanger 1. In heat exchanger 1, cooling of this air takes place from 3 to 4. This cooled air then passes through the auxiliary compressor. In the auxiliary compressor, the air is further compressed to 0.5, and this compressed air again it gets cooled in second heat exchanger, and this high pressure air then passes on to the cooling turbine where expansion takes place. This cycle has been shown here on TS diagram. 1 to 2 is ram compression, 2 to 3 it is main compressor, the power compressor of the airplane. Then 3 to 4, the cooling takes place by ram air in the heat exchanger 1. 4 to 5, it is compression for the second compression in the auxiliary compressor, and 4 to 5 cooling takes place in the heat exchanger 2, and then 6 to 7 the expansion takes place in the cooling turbine. Here we can very well see and compare with the simple cycle, the pressure ratio available is extremely high as compared to simple cycle, and because of this high compression, high expansion ratio available, the chilling would be more, the cooling capacity of the same quantity of air would be more, and the pressurizing capacity will also increase. So, this is how a bootstrap cycle can work. There are many more combinations that can be made in air cycles, but they are beyond the scope of this lecture and they can be discussed in details while studying the refrigeration engineering. Then we come to the next part of our discussion today, that is the vapor compression refrigeration cycles. A vapor compression cycle is a reversed Rankine cycle. Rankine cycle is a power cycle. If the Rankine cycle is reversed, it becomes a vapor compression refrigeration cycle as just now discussed, and the variation is that the pump is replaced by a throttle valve in a refrigeration cycle. A Rankine cycle uses a pump to raise the pressure of water from condenser pressure to boiler pressure. Here that pump is replaced by a throttle valve to reduce the pressure, and a compressor is replaced by the a compressor replaces the turbine. The turbine that we had in a Rankine cycle is now replaced by a compressor. The cycle is shown here. The refrigerant is compressed in the compressor. When the refrigerant is compressed in the compressor, the pressure of the refrigerant increases, the temperature also increases. The temperature is beyond the atmospheric temperature, and when the gas passes through this condenser here, the heat will be lost to the atmosphere. The temperature of the refrigerant being higher than the atmospheric temperature, heat will be rejected to the atmosphere. This cooled refrigerant then passes on to the expansion valve, and in the expansion valve throttling takes place. When the pressure reduces, the saturation temperature also reduces, and when the pressure and temperature of the refrigerant they reduce and they pass on to the evaporator, the low temperature refrigerant will pick up heat from the evaporator, and the latent heat will be absorbed. The refrigerant will become that will evaporate, and it will become it will come into the gaseous state, and the refrigerating effect will be produced. The cycle is shown on pH and TS diagrams here in this diagram, and the refrigerant is compressed from 1 to 2 in the compressor isentropically, then 2 to 3 it is the heat that is being rejected at constant pressure in the condenser. Cooling is done to a point where it becomes a saturated liquid, and at 3 when it becomes saturated liquid, the refrigerant is throttled. When the refrigerant is throttled, we can see that some of it evaporates, and when it evaporates, it will draw its heat, latent heat of evaporation, from within the mass of the refrigerant. Its temperature will reduce, and this low temperature refrigerant, when passes on through the evaporator, it will pick up heat from the refrigerator from the evaporator, and refrigerating effect is produced during process 4-1. The cycle has been shown here on the TS diagram. 1-2 is isentropic compression, 2-3 is liquefaction, the heat rejection process. Then 3-4, this is the point 4, it is throttling process, and 4-1 it picks up heat. This orange color shows the work that is being consumed during the cycle. Work consumed during the cycle is 1-3 and this point 4- we can say, and the refrigerating effect that will be produced is area under curve 4-1, H1 minus H4 is the refrigerating effect, right. On pH diagram, work done will be H2 minus H1 and refrigerating effect will be H1 minus H4. that has been shown here. Refrigerating effect would be H1 minus H4, that is area 1, 4 A B. This is 1, 4 A B, that is the refrigerating effect shown by light blue color, and the work done will be H2 minus H1, that is 1, 2, 3, this C and 1. This is the area orange color, that is the work done, and the coefficient of performance would be N upon W, that is H1 minus H4 divided by H2 minus H1, that is the area, this area blue color divided by this area orange color, right. So, this is the coefficient of performance of a simple vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Now, what are the parameters that would affect the performance of a refrigeration cycle? The parameters that would affect the refrigeration cycles would be this area, this is the refrigerating effect, this should be maximum, and the work done should be minimum. When the work done is minimum and refrigerating effect is maximum, the coefficient of performance would be maximum, N by W. N should be large, W should be small. N should be large means this area should be as large as possible, W should be small, that means this area should be as small as possible. So, make this area small, what do? We make either move this line up or move this line down, the area will reduce, or when this area, this line is moved up, the refrigerating effect increases automatically. So, the parameters that would affect the coefficient of performance or performance of refrigeration cycle are the evaporator pressure, this pressure, the condenser pressure, this pressure, and suction vapor superheat, that is this refrigerating effect can be increased in this direction also. We will consider these three parameters and see how they affect the performance of a vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Let us study the effect of evaporator pressure first of all. Say the evaporator pressure is reduced from 1.4, it is brought down to 1.4. If we reduce the evaporator pressure, what happens is that the work done was H2 minus H1, now it is H2 dash minus H1 dash, and therefore, we see that this distance H2 dash minus H1 dash is more than H2 minus H1, and therefore, if the evaporator pressure reduces, the work done will increase. The refrigerating effect was H1 minus H4, now it is H1 dash minus H4 dash. This curve is moving in this direction, and therefore, refrigerating effect reduces. So, if the evaporator pressure reduces, the refrigerating effect reduces and the work done increases, and therefore, the coefficient of performance will decrease, as well as the capacity of the refrigerating plant will also decrease. Then, the effect of condenser pressure, if the condenser pressure is raised, it is very clear that the condenser pressure, if it increases, the work done increases. This is the amount of additional work that is required to be done. The refrigerating effect remains constant. H1 minus H4 dash is same as H1 minus H4. So, if the condenser pressure increases, the work refrigerating effect remains constant, but the work input increases, and that is going to reduce the coefficient of performance of a vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Third parameter is the effect of suction vapor superheat. If the vapor is superheated at suction, instead of 1, it is the inlet temperature is 1 dash, we find that the refrigerating effect increases. H1 minus H4, now it is H1 dash minus H4. So, refrigerating effect has increased, whereas the work input is now that is also increased, because these lines being diverging lines, H2 dash minus H1 dash is greater than H2 minus H1. So, the refrigerating effect increases, the work input also increases, and therefore, the coefficient of performance may increase or may decrease, that depends upon nature of the refrigerant used. Normally, a superheated suction is preferable in all cases, because at least the refrigerating capacity of the plant will increase. The refrigerating effect increases, that means the total capacity in tons will increase. The coefficient of performance may also increase. For freons, the nature of the refrigerant is such that the coefficient of performance will increase, but ammonia is a refrigerant where the coefficient of performance may decrease because of superheat. But anyway, superheat is desirable, and 5 to 10 degrees of superheat is kept in all refrigeration systems. Then finally, we can say that because if we can conclude that what is the overall effect of these three parameters, we can say that the temperatures should be kept . What we have discussed up to now is that the condenser pressure should be kept low, evaporator pressure should be kept high, and the temperature of the refrigerant at inlet to the compressor or at outlet to the evaporator should be slightly superheated. Now, these terms low, high, or some superheat are vague. We must know what should be the pressure, how low it should be, how high it should be, and what should be the degree of superheat. So, condenser pressure should be kept as close as the saturation pressure at the sink temperature. Sink temperature determines, the atmospheric temperature determines the pressure that should be maintained in the condenser, and the temperature at outlet to the condenser, temperature of the refrigerant at outlet to the condenser should be as close as the atmospheric temperature or the sink temperature, and pressure should correspond to that particular temperature. Similarly, evaporator pressure should be as high as possible, but again this is determined by the temperature of the application that is required in the refrigeration system. If we need a temperature of minus 10 degrees centigrade in the evaporator, then the evaporator pressure should correspond to that particular temperature of minus 10 degrees centigrade, and it will be saturation temperature corresponding to the evaporator temperature, but there should not be large gap between the saturation pressure in the evaporator and the actual evaporator pressure, because if the evaporator pressure is kept below the saturation pressure, desirable saturation pressure, then the performance will reduce. And the degree of superheat of 5 to 10 degrees centigrade is desirable at evaporator outlet. So, that is how we determine these parameters to optimize the conditions. Another parameter that affects the performance is the subcooling. The refrigerant at outlet to the evaporator, outlet to the condenser should be, the temperature should be as low as possible, as it has been shown here. If the temperature reduces from 3 to 3 dash, an extra refrigeration is available in the evaporator 4 to 4 dash, and for this no extra work is required to be done, and therefore the coefficient of performance will improve if the temperature if the refrigerant is subcooled at outlet to the condenser. So, it has been the conclusions I have already explained to you. The evaporator pressure should be as high as possible, the condenser pressure should be as low as possible, refrigerant should be slightly superheated, and refrigerant after condenser should be subcooled to the lowest possible temperature. Then another vapor refrigeration system is the vapor absorption refrigeration system. And the vapor compression system, a compressor was being used to raise the pressure of the refrigerant to condenser pressure, and as such the condensation can take place in the evaporator in the condenser, and refrigeration can be obtained. However, the reciprocating compressors, rotary compressors compressing the vapor, they compress the vapor in a vapor state, and in vapor state the change in volume is very large, and when the change in volume is very large, the work required to compress the refrigerant is very large, and to save on that work that is being consumed in the compressor, another refrigeration system that is known as vapor absorption system is used. It differs from a compression system by the method of raising the pressure of refrigerant from evaporator pressure to condenser pressure. In compression system, a compressor is used to draw refrigerant in vapor state from the evaporator. This vapor is compressed to superheated state, raising its pressure and discharge to the condenser, and mechanical energy is consumed, which is high grade energy. This figure shows that the compressor has been replaced by another system that would raise the pressure, and this system is an absorber, a liquid pump, and a generator. In this, heat energy is being used to raise the pressure, raise the refrigerant. In absorption refrigeration, the low pressure refrigerant vapor is absorbed in a solvent and a liquid solution is formed. The pressure of the liquid solution is raised to condenser pressure using a liquid pump. This high pressure solution is heated in a boiler to drive the refrigerant vapor out from the solution. Solution is boiled, and when the solution is boiled, the solvent is left behind and the refrigerant vapor is driven off from the solution. This refrigerant passes on to the condenser, and as such the function of a compressor is accomplished by a combination of absorber, pump, and generator. Here it was a compressor. Compressor has been replaced by an absorber. Absorber consists of a solvent. This solvent has a great affinity towards the refrigerant. Refrigerant is sucked by the solvent because of its affinity, and a solution is formed. This solution, the liquid form, the pressure is raised. This is a liquid solution, and therefore it is a incompressible fluid. This incompressible fluid would consume a very little energy to raise its pressure. This high pressure refrigerant then passes on to the generator, where heat is supplied, and the because of its high temperature, the refrigerant is driven out, the liquid solvent is left behind. This liquid solution is sent back to the absorber for completing the cycle, and this refrigerant after condenser expansion valve goes to the evaporator, and refrigerating effect is produced. So, this is how this combination of absorber, pump, and generator can replace a compressor doing its job. Advantages of this combination are: the mechanical work consumed, which is high grade energy, is insignificant as compared to the work consumed in a compressor. Heat is required to be supplied in the generator, which is low grade energy. Heat is a low grade energy, it costs less as compared to mechanical energy, and waste heat can also be used wherever it is available in the process industries or industries. Lot of heat is available as a waste at lower temperatures, and that waste heat can be used to in a generator as a heat source, and refrigeration can be attained. the coefficient of performance of absorption system can be calculated, and it comes out to be quite efficient system. A vapor absorption system is a heat operated refrigerating machine. It may be considered a refrigerator driven by a heat engine as shown here. There is a heat source, it drives the heat engine, it consumes certain quantity of heat QG and rejects part of it QA, and certain amount of work is being done. This work is consumed by the refrigerator, which draws heat at a lower temperature QC from the low temperature heat, so from the evaporator, and rejects it to the atmosphere. Now, this heat engine operated between source temperature TG and sink temperature TA. The output of the engine drives the refrigerator operating between the evaporator temperature TE and atmospheric temperature TA. Output of the engine is equal to the energy required in the refrigerator. Output of the engine is equal to the work required in the refrigerator, and the coefficient of performance of the cycle can be computed like this. The coefficient of performance is equal to the refrigerating effect QE divided by QG, and we can write this as W upon QG into QE by W. W goes off, it becomes QE by QG. We can write the rewrite this as like this, and W by QG is efficiency of the heat engine, QE by W is coefficient of performance of the refrigerant. Thermal efficiency of a heat engine is given by this for a Carnot engine, and thermal efficiency of a Carnot refrigerator is given by this. So, the coefficient of performance of absorption system is the efficiency of a heat engine multiplied by efficiency of a refrigerator. We can rewrite this as TG minus TA divided by TA minus TE to TE by TG. So, this gives us the efficiency of a vapor absorption system. The coefficient of performance for a theoretical cycle is very high, and irrespective the irreversibilities involved in vapor absorption refrigeration cycles are very large because of the solution that is formed in the absorber, the heat that is supplied in the generator, that is again a irreversible process, and the irreversibility is being very high. The losses in the cycle would be very large, and as such, as compared to vapor compression systems, the efficiency of an actual vapor absorption system would be very low, and this cycle would be economical and useful only for those applications where waste heat is available in the industries at low temperatures, or and it can also be used for applications where solar energy can be used for driving the vapor absorption refrigeration system, and there it finds its application to a large extent where solar energy can also be used as its source for running the vapor absorption refrigeration system. So, that is where a vapor absorption system finds its application in abundance.